Okay, good morning and welcome back to second part of the latest amendments for AY 2021 applicable for May 20 as well as November 20 attempt. Part 1 we already finished last time. Today we'll be continuing with the part 2. But before we start with part 2, some small furthermore changes made by government which are pertaining to the part that we already discussed in the previous session. Okay, usme 2-3 places you need to make some changes. One is that section 269 SU, one is 194N TDS on bank withdrawal of more than 1 crore, and the third change to be made will be in section 115BAB. So I'm right now starting with section 115BAB. 115BAB, that is 15% tax rate wala section, which was introduced from this year by Nirmala Sitaraman on 20th September 2019, section was introduced with effect from 1st April 2019. That 115BAB from AY 2021, domestic company which is engaged into manufacturing, but other than company referred to in 115BA and BAA. BA means 25% tax rate and BAA means 22% tax rate. Barring these two, any domestic company which is engaged into manufacturing, then amendment has been made. What amendment has been made? Here, the language used by Nirmala Sitaraman was total income without claiming 13 benefits, 12 benefits, total income would be taxed at 15% plus compulsory surcharge 10% plus health and education cess. And option once exercise cannot be changed. There are 3-4 changes made out here. The very first change is that this 15% will now be applicable not on total income other than incomes covered by this chapter. 15% will no more be applicable on total income. First of all, company is not supposed to carry on any other activity other than manufacturing, producing, R&D activity in relation to manufacturing and transportation in relation to manufacturing. Barring this, company is not supposed to do any other business activity. But the company may still have house property income, company may have income from other source, investment income, etc. Company may have other incomes also. So clarification has been inserted by Nirmala Sitaraman on 11th December 2019 that 15% will be applicable only on those incomes which are incidental to manufacturing. Manufacturing income or producing income and income from incidental activity. If company has other incomes, then this 15% will not apply. What will be the rate of tax applicable on such other income like house property income, etc.? Then tax rate will be not 15, will not even be 30%, will not even be 25%, but the tax rate on other than manufacturing related income will be 22%. But surcharge will be 0%, 7%, 12% or will be 10%. The clarification inserted, surcharge rate will be 10% only for tax on each and every income. But 15% rate benefit will be given only to PGBP income from manufacturing and manufacturing related activity, incidental to surcharge will be compulsory. Surcharge is compulsory for 115BAA also, where 22%. Last lecture you were absent. We had discussed this, no? These two new sections introduced. Okay. So on other incomes, rate will not be 15%. I mean, non-manufacturing activity related income, that is other than PGBP, HP income, company cannot have salary income, HP income, other sources income, etc. Surcharge will be 10% only and will not be 0, 7 and 12%, though the rate of tax will be regular. Another change has been made. If you recollect, there are 3-4 changes made. One by one. This is the first change. Second change, if you recollect, this company is prohibited from using, if you recollect, in order to avail 15% rate, the new business should not have been set up by transferring to it second-hand plant machinery, that is previously used plant machinery, subject to two exceptions, imported and 20% wala exception. Total of second-hand does not exceed 20% of total plant machinery. There's one more restriction. New business should not have been set up by splitting up or reconstruction of an already existing business. And one more restriction was that this new business should not have been started by transferring to new business of any building which was previously used as a hotel or a convention center. Now, amendment has been made, provided apart from this, it says provided it was not started by transferring to it of building which was previously used as a hotel or convention center on which deduction under 80ID was claimed. Deduction under 80ID was claimed. 80ID is deleted. It's been 2 years. Okay. So For the purpose of 115 BAB, option to pay 15% tax plus compulsory surcharge, irrespective of the amount of NTI, instead of 30% or 25%, is available to domestic companies subject to following condition. First condition, it should be company other than company referred to in 115 BA and BAA. Second, it should have been set up and registered, both set up also as well as registered also, both on or after 1st October 2019, and it starts manufacturing on or before 31st March 2023. These are the basic primary conditions. Another condition, company should not have been formed by splitting up or reconstruction of an already existing business, except in case of that 33B wala section exception, that which is nonsense, again a blunder by government. And company does not use any plant machinery which was previously used, subject to two exceptions. This much we discussed, no changes are made. What are the changes? Next, company, here changes are made. Company does not use any building which was previously used as hotel or a convention center. The sentence ended here only. But now sentence is continued further, which Nirmala Sitaraman ji, she forgot. So now she inserted that, in respect of which build hotel or a convention center, in respect of which deduction under ATID has been claimed and allowed. Maybe in past, ATID is no more allowable. AY 1819 was the last year. AY 1920, today is AY 2021. ATID is no more allowable. If previously it was claimed, then now it cannot be, that particular building should not be used in this new business. Okay. Company is not engaged, next amendment made, company should not be engaged in any other business other than the business of manufacturing or producing article or thing, research in relation to or distribution of article or thing, that is transportation, manufacturing, R&D and distribution of such goods manufactured. Now what is manufacturing? That has been clarified, a negative list has been inserted which was not there earlier, that following five activities will not be amounting to manufacturing, will not be considered as manufacturing. Number one, development of computer software in any form, development of a computer software in any form or in any media. Next, mining. Third, conversion of marble blocks or similar items into slabs. Big marble blocks are cut and they are converted into slabs and then they are polished, so that will not be considered as manufacturing activity. Bottling of gas into cylinder will also not be considered as manufacturing. Printing of books will not be considered as manufacturing. And last, production of film, production of cinematograph films will also not be considered manufacturing. And last one, technically only five, last one, any other business or any other activity as may be notified by central government in this behalf in future. Yahan tak dekhega na camera. Are you clear? These activity. Now, those who are viewing video recorded lectures, for them new sheet would be provided latest with incorporating all the amendments. Whatever I've covered here, that was not there in the previous sheet. Previous sheet was given only to face-to-face students, that stands scrap. New sheet has been given to you today in the second half of the amendment lecture, incorporating all these changes. Are you clear? So manufacturing does not include five activities. Which of them are important in my opinion? In my opinion, production of cinematograph film, printing of books is important point. Printing of books is important. Why printing of books is an important point? The reason is that if you recollect PGBP chapter, section 32 subsection 1 clause 2A, additional depreciation, section 32 subsection 1 clause 2A, additional depreciation on new plant machinery is available only to those who are into manufacturing or generation of power or generation, transmission or distribution of power. For the purpose of additional depreciation, there was a CBDT press release 3 years back that printing of books and printing and publishing of books will be amounting to manufacture, will entitle the SSC to claim additional depreciation on new plant machinery. So for the purpose of additional depreciation, printing of books amounts to manufacture, but not for the purpose of 115BAB. Not for the purpose of 115BAB. And also, development of computer software, this is also important. This is important, mining is important, printing of books is important. These three are important in my opinion. Production of film can also be considered, but it's okay. I mean, mainly printing of books in my opinion is an important point in this negative list of five activities. Acha, then total income is computed without claiming so and so benefit. This we are already done with. There are no changes here. Another change that has been made is that how many amendments we discuss? Two. Building used as hotel convention, usme ATID has been added. Second, manufacturing is defined in a negative manner. Third amendment made, if you recollect, some people may try to take an undue advantage. So what I will do, I am eligible for 30% tax rate being a company. I am not eligible for 15% because mine is not a newly set up company. So, but suppose any Karthik, right? Ritik, sorry. Karthik, Aryan, Ritik, Roshan, both are same. They both look alike. So suppose any Ritik Roshan or Ritik Jain, he has set up a company eligible for 15% rate. He's a friend of mine. So what I will do purposely, I will smartly shift my income to him. I will manipulate the books of accounts in such a way that whatever sales is executed by me, I will transfer the sales to him. What? Whatever we discuss for transfer pricing chapter, that I will do at local level. Huh? So that my income, instead of 4,000 crore per annum, I will show income of 5-6 crore. That income I will transfer to him. So that income is generated to him, or more than normal profits are generated to him. In such situation, there was a clause inserted. If assessing officer of this company, Karthik company, Ritik company, finds that more than ordinary profits are generated by him, then this section will not apply. But that was an incomplete amendment, incomplete clause. Nirmala Sitaraman, she just inserted a clause that company which has opted for 115BAB 15% rate, if assessing officer of that company finds that more than ordinary profits are generated through person with whom special relationship is there, then provisions of this section will not apply. But then what will happen, that was not clarified. So now it is clarified on 11th December 2019 that such extra profits which are more than ordinary profits as per AO, of course appealable by assessee, but such extra profits will not get the benefit of 15% plus will be taxable at 30% rate. 30% rate, that has been clarified. Owing to the close connection between the company, and the other person, if more than ordinary or for any other reason in the course of business between them, if the business is so arranged between them that the business transacted between them produces to the assessee company more than the ordinary profits which could have been expected to have been earned, then AO shall, in computing the profits and gains of such company for the purposes of this section, take the amount of profit as may be deemed to have been derived therefrom. So suppose Ritik should have earned profit as per normal provisions, he should have earned 10 crore profit, but because of close connection with somebody, 100 crore profit is generated. So 90 crore is more than ordinary. So provisions up till now, what was written was that AO will, though he has shown 100 crore, AO will recompute correct amount of profit should have been 10 crore. This section of 15% tax rate will be applied only on 10 crore. But what will happen to balance 90 crore, that was not clarified. So now clarify. Provided. So now this has been clarified, such excess profit, which is 90 crore in our example, excess profit determined by AO shall be subject to tax at 34.32% rate. 30% plus compulsory surcharge 10%. Now here surcharge will not be 0, 7 or 12. The tax rate will be normal tax rate 30%, but surcharge will be 10% only. Whatever is the surcharge rate applicable under this section. This is something which is unusual. If the rate of tax applicable on such excess profit is normal tax rate 30% and not 15%, the surcharge rate should have also been normal, but surcharge rate will not be normal in any situation. Entire income will be subjected to surcharge. Tax on entire income will be subjected to surcharge at 10% rate only. Effective rate will be 34.32%. This is an extra point inserted. This is the third amendment. Which was the first amendment? ATID wala. Second was manufacturing negative list introduced. Third amendment is extra profits will be taxed at 34.32. This clarification was not there earlier, was introduced later. Fourth amendment in point number J or whatever, it was clarified that assessee company will be given this option of 115BAB only if assessee chooses this option in the IT return. It was not clarified which IT return. First IT return, second IT return, third IT return. So it's been clarified, the word first has been inserted. Provisions will be allowed to the eligible assessee only if option has been exercised on or before the due date of filing the first of the returns of income. The word first was missing. That has been inserted now. that has been inserted. This makes sense. This makes sense. So understand very clearly, very important thing, 115 BAA, that is 22% tax rate, which is available to all companies. Existing companies also can switch over to this. New company can also opt for this. It could be manufacturing, non-manufacturing, any company. And 115 BAB, which is 15% tax rate, is only for manufacturing company. Now this section can be opted for any time, can be opted for at any time, even in future also. The government says if you don't want to switch over to this right now, because if company switches over to this, then MAT credit and all those things will lapse, will not be allowed. An option cannot be changed lifetime. Therefore, here an option choice is given to the company that if you don't want to, existing companies, if you don't want to switch over to this section, 22% tax rate right now, you can do it in future. But once you opt for it, lifetime you have to go for that, this section only. So it can be opted for any time. But as far as 115 BAB is concerned, the option is not given lifetime. Option is to be exercised in the first IT return only. If in the first IT return, after the company is set up, if the option is not exercised, then option cannot be exercised lifetime. So this will be like a once in a lifetime opportunity. It is a closed ended scheme as compared to 115BAA, which is an open ended scheme. One can opt in any time. Once opted in, both the section, once opted in, option cannot be changed. But 115BAB, you SSC cannot make a choice in the second, third, fourth, fifth year, etc. Has to make a choice in the first year itself after the company has been set up and registered. Okay, this is the fourth amendment made. Clear? Okay. One more amendment has been made. Okay, option is not selected, in the then lifetime 30, 25 or 22% rate will be applied. How 30% and how 25%? 25% is the turnover 2 years, 30 is a normal tax rate, 25 2 years back turnover sales did not exceed 400 crore. And 22% if company switches over to 115BAA, which that option can be exercised any moment, anytime. So once the option is exercised, cannot be changed lifetime, cannot be changed lifetime. So there were some lines in the old sheet that option could be, you know, changed whenever selected. I mean, option can be selected second year, third year, whenever company wants. Whenever, nahi, it has to be exercised in the first year only. Otherwise, lifetime will not be available. Okay. MAT provision we already discussed. To add 22%, it can, so 22% is not automatically available. If company has to switch over to 115BAA, so technically tax rate, if this option is not exercised of 115BAB, then tax rate would be 30 or 25 only. 22 is possible if company switches over to 115BAA, and once it switches over to 115BAA, these two will disappear, right? Okay. Okay, Matt, and then this table which was given, which is making comparison. Well, I don't know how Institute got to know about this table. Institute has also produced similar table in the notification which Institute issued recently. Institute issued this notification in January 7th somewhere, 7 January 2020 somewhere, few days back. But Institute has made comparison between these two sections only. I have compared between three sections. Another thing, Institute people have, you know, they have not followed alphabetical order. They've given BAB on the left hand side and BAA on the right hand side. So again, creates confusion. Okay, every time I have to look at the title, array, this is BAA and not BAB. So one has to be very careful. I'll just briefly explain you what all changes to be made here. Change, those who are using, those who are watching video recorded lectures, they need not make any changes. Those who are using the old sheet, if you want to continue with the old sheet, please make changes. First point, no change. 25, 22. Surcharge compulsorily here 10%, 10%, and for 115BA, 0, 7 and 12 will continue. These two places surcharge mandatory. 115BA surcharge will be attracted only if total income exceeds 1 crore, 10 crore, etc. Domestic or foreign company, to all three of them should be domestic only. Benefits given only to domestic company. MAT provisions, minimum alternate tax provisions, everyone look up here. For 115BA company, MAT provision applicable, and for these two companies, not applicable, not applicable. And when we say MAT provisions do not apply, that means MAT credit also will not be available. However, CBDT clarified that existing MAT credit also will not be available that problem, that will not create problem for this company because this is a newly incorporated company, will not have any MAT credit. Problem will arise only for this company, which is an existing company switching over to 22% tax rate. For them, existing MAT credit will lapse. Therefore, option is given to them that if you do not want to switch over to BA right now, BAA section right now, then you go, after exhausting your MAT credit, after exhausting your 10AA SEZ, after exhausting brought forward losses, after exhausting everything, whenever you want to switch over, company can switch over. This facility not available for 115BAB. MAT credit here will be available in 115BA. BAA and BAB not available because whole chapter only is not going to be applicable. Deduction on 10AA, 32(1) clause 2A, that is additional depre, 32AD, Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, Telangana, West Bengal, extra plant machinery, 33AB, 33ABA, tea, coffee, rubber development account, site restoration account, section 35 scientific R&D, 35CCC, 35CCD, agricultural extension project, skill development project, chapter 6A deduction under heading C other than 80JJA, JJAA, additional employment. Are you all able to recollect? All these benefits are not going to be available for all three. Not available, not allowed, not allowed. This is common for all three. Income to be computed by following so-and-so rate, so-and-so provision. Companies will have to compromise with so-and-so. So what all things are common in all three? Company should be domestic company, foreign company benefit not given, and the income to be computed without claiming so-and-so, without claiming so-and-so. Other deductions will be allowed. Okay, what all things are common between these two sections, 115BAA and BAB? Surcharge is mandatory, irrespective of income. Surcharge rate is 10%. Both of them are for domestic company. MAT not applicable. MAT credit also not allowed. And even these benefits, this is also common. Not allowed. I forgot. And this benefit, this is common for all three. That total income should be computed without claiming so and so. Clear? Okay. Then use of previously used plant machinery, subject to two exceptions. Total second hand plant machinery value does not exceed 20%, or if it is imported from a country outside India, subject to these two exceptions. This rule, this condition is only for last company, 115BAB. Not there for BAA, BAA also, and BA also, and last section may it is applicable. Meaning thereby, only for 115BAB, second hand plant machinery not allowed, that condition is applicable. First two section, second hand plant machinery is fine. Similarly, use of building which was previously used as a hotel or a convention center. And what is the extra amendment made here in respect of which deduction has been claimed and allowed under 80ID. Okay, this condition is also for the last section. First two section, such buildings are allowed. Last section ke liye such building not allowed. What is the logic behind this condition? Nobody understands. Government has also failed to clarify what is the logic behind this condition. Second hand is okay, understood. Why second hand ke liye prohibition is there, but this condition is totally useless, nonsense it is. Setting up of a new business by way of splitting up or reconstruction of already existing business. This condition again applicable only for the last section. Allowed, allowed, not allowed for 115BAB. We already discussed in the last lecture. And the type of business allowed to be undertaken, type of business should be for 115BA, it should be manufacturing, only manufacturing. 115BAB also only manufacturing. 115BAA any business. Huh, manufacturing means manufacturing, R&D in relation to manufacturing, or distribution of such goods and articles manufactured. That is manufacturing. Okay, only manufacturing, R&D and distribution of 115BAA any business allowed. And last section ke liye 115BAB only manufacturing, R&D and distribution. Another thing I would like to bring to your notice, an important point, the negative list of manufacturing which we discussed today, 5 items given and 6-1 was any other business as may be notified, that list is included only for 115BAB. It's not for BAA. BAA mein toh any company is allowed, even service providing company can also switch over to 115BAA. JK Shah Classes Private Limited, that company can also switch over to this. Any company. TCS, Tata Consultancy Service, can also switch over. Okay, but Tata Consultancy Service, which is into development of software, computer software, cannot opt for 115BAB because development of software is not considered as manufacturing. But for 115BA, but 115BA, that list is not, negative list does not apply to 115BA, but 115BA too is pointless, useless nowadays. this section. Okay, so the list is negative list which we discussed today is only for 115BAB. Condition with regards to date of setup and registration. So for 115BA, the company had to be set up on or after 1st March 2016. 115BAA ke liye anytime, existing company can also switch over. Company could have been set up in 1960s and 1970s, anytime. And for 115BAB, it should have been set up on or after 1st October 19. Plus, there's a condition with regards to starting of the manufacturing activity. Manufacturing activity should have started off on or before 31st March 2023. Okay, these are the changes made. Okay, well, one more amendment has been made that any income which is not incidental to manufacturing, house property, etc., that will be taxed as per normal rate. That will be taxed as per normal rate as applicable. Normal rate would then be 22% and not 25% or 30%. Excess profit more than the ordinary profits computed by AO will be taxed at 30% rate plus 10% surcharge, 4% health and education says. Other non-business income, HP cannot have salary income, but HP income and capital gains will be taxed. Capital gains will be taxed as per normally 10%, 20% with indexation, without indexation. That is a different story. Capital gain ke upar normal tax rate will apply. 112A wala capital gain, LTCG arising from transfer of equity shares exceeding 1 lakh rupees will be taxed at 10%. That is also fine. But other business, other incomes other than business activity, other than manufacturing activity, that is PGBP income from trading activity, then HP income and income from other sources, debenture interest, FD interest, bond interest, these income will be taxed at 22% plus compulsory surcharge 10% plus health and education says. Effective rate will be something around 24 point something, whatever is the rate, ghar jaake kar lena. But surcharge rate on such income will be 10%. Short-term capital gain, if it is special short-term capital gain covered by 111A, then 15%. Other short-term capital gain, 22% under other income category. So short-term capital gains will also come under this category. So what will be taxed at 22, in spite of 15% rate being applicable, short-term capital gains other than 111A wala gains will be taxed at 22%. HP income, other source income, and non-manufacturing business trading activity income will all be taxable at 22%, but surcharge rate will be 10%. Other than PGBP income, plus within PGBP also any other income other than manufacturing, anything which is not incidental to manufacturing. Supposing I am into manufacturing of this, apart from this air mouse, I start selling this, I'm manufacturing, plus I start purchasing and selling of marker pen, trading activity, that's business income also. Though it is business income, income from sale of marker pen will be taxed at 22% because I'm not manufacturing, it is not incidental to manufacturing, right? Okay, this section comes to an end. So trading activity technically not allowed only. Trading activity if it does, sorry, the trading activity if it gets involved into, then option will be invalid. And then company 15% tax rate will stop being applicable permanently. Permanently. Option. Correct. So technically it would be other than PGBP, right? Trading activity wouldn't be allowed only. Trading activity would not be possible also. In case if it starts trading or doing some other activity other than manufacturing, house property is fine because that's not under PGBP. Should be engaged only into manufacturing, R&D and distribution. But capital gain, other source income are allowed. That is not prohibited directly. Right? Okay. No changes further in this particular chapter. Next changes are made in 269SS, 269T, 269ST, 269SU. One new section was introduced from AY 2021 about 269SU, the last section. There some changes are made, dates have been changed and some modes have been prescribed. Last lecture we were criticizing whom? Nirmala Sitaraman ji, bichari lady. But now she realized her mistake and she changed. Opportunity of being heard should be given to everyone. So 1st November 2019 onwards, this section was going to be applicable. But applicability has now been postponed to 1st January 2020. She postponed it by 2 months because people complain, yes sir, modes have not been prescribed. This amendment was made on 30th December 2019. 30th December notification came. Technically, this notification is not applicable because only those notifications which are up to 31st October, that is 6 months before the May attempt, are applicable for May attempt, 6 months before the first day of exam. But our institute has issued clarification that this will be applicable and you'll have to do it. Very simple it is. Date of applicability is postponed by 2 months. Instead of 1st November, it will be applicable to applicable from 1st January 2020. This amendment was by way of notification issued on 30th December. What was it? Section 216 SU, every person carrying on business, whether it is company, firm, LLP, everyone, individuals also, sole proprietary concerns, carrying on business shall provide facility for accepting payment through prescribed electronic modes in addition to the facility of electronic modes which are already offered, if any, being provided by such person. Like they will have to. So if the sales, but however this section is applicable only if the total sales gross receipt turnover of the immediately preceding previous year exceeds 50 crore rupees in the immediately preceding previous year. So what all change have been made? So two changes. First of all, date of applicability is postponed by 2 months. There's a 5,000 rupee penalty for failure to provide this facility. Second change has been made is rule 119AA has been inserted in the by way of same notification. Following modes have been prescribed. Debit card powered by RuPay, not MasterCard and Visa or American Express, that is MX. Apart from MasterCard, Visa, MX, company will have to, or the SSC will have to offer accepting payment by way of debit card powered by RuPay. I had one RuPay debit card which is similar to MasterCard. To a great surprise, I'm having it. HDFC Bank has issued it to me and I'm one of their privileged customer. I'm maintaining a very high amount of bank balance. They issued it to me only for that bank. Now I've withdrawn everything. I've become poor now financially. So, but this RuPay card is not accepted at most of the merchant establishments. I was really shocked. So the very good thing that government has done, that everyone will start accepting RuPay card. Why are we promoting international or foreign companies, MasterCard, Visa, American Express? Why don't we promote our Indian? RuPay is much better than MasterCard. Much better, but it's a powerful system. Our, at least our financial data will remain in the country, will not be shared with American companies. Debit card powered by RuPay, BHIM Unified Payment Interface, that is UPI, BHIM UPI, and UPI Quick Response Code, that is QR code, BHIM QR code and BHIM Unified Payment Interface. Three modes prescribed. Default to attract penalty under 271DB, 5,000 per day. However, applicability of this penalty will not be from 1st January. This will be applicable. This was also going to be applicable from 1st November 2019. But instead of 1st November, it's been postponed. This penalty will not even start from 1st January. This will start from 1st February. Postponed to 1st February 2020. Postponed by 3 months. Why not from 1st January only? Because this notification came on 30th December. So after 2 days, within 2 days, people can't make changes. People can't make changes. So these are the changes made. 30th December 2019. So, okay, clear about this? Okay, and 269SST. Okay, just a small thing I would like to bring it to your notice. It's really shocking. It's really surprising. Continuing with the tradition, Arun Jaitley and then Nirmala Sitaraman, brother, sister, all in the family. These people in the current year, AY 2021, at around 9 different sections, they've introduced in 9 sections of the whole act, including 40A3, PGBP, 269SS, 269T, everywhere, the payment or the receipt had to be by way of account pay check, account pay draft, ECS through a bank. Everywhere government added 4th mode. Account pay check, account pay draft, ECS through a bank, and last mode was introduced. Any other prescribed, any other electronic mode as may be prescribed by government. So now this notification which is showed, I'm issued, I checked it so many times to confirm whether I'm wrong or right. These three modes which are prescribed, idiot people have prescribed it only for 216 SU. They should have done it for all the 9 sections. So for remaining 8 section including 40A3, 269SS, 269S, 216ST and 269T, 35AD, 43(1), this is not applicable to other section. They have specifically mentioned for the purpose of 269SU. Or the baki section, remaining sections, who will do? Who will prescribe? So now they will realize, maybe next month they will again incorporate some changes. But I don't think so, institute will ask on that. Arre, I'm not doing it. Shrimati, 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 Nirmala Sitaraman, she is doing it. Let's start with you. Let's start with you. Charity begins at home. Okay, with that, this chapter comes to an end. We are running short of time. So let's proceed further. Okay, now next thing is to be changed is as compared to whatever we discussed in our last session, 194N, TDS. TDS, there were 2 sections newly introduced, 194M and 194N. N for Nihit sir, from 1st September 19, TDS on cash withdrawal. Cash withdrawal from any, TDS on cash, 2% TDS on cash withdrawal exceeding 1 crore. From any bank account, savings account, current account, any bank account. Okay, now this is applicable. There were some exceptions introduced that this section, no TDS if the person withdrawing is so and so person. Section is applicable to all types of banks making payment exceeding 1 crore on account of withdrawal from bank account, whether it is cooperative bank, post office bank, or it is banking company. All the 3 types of bank, all types of banks, simply any bank making payment to customer will have to withdraw. There were some exceptions introduced, no TDS under 194N if recipient is government, any banking company, cooperative bank, post office bank, any business correspondent of white label, okay, business correspondent of the bank in accordance with guidelines issued by RBI under RBI Act, and any white label automated teller machine ATM operator of the banking company, cooperative bank, in accordance with authorization issued by RBI under Payment and Settlement Systems Act. Okay, these 4 were the exception. They were already there. They were introduced from the beginning. Now, in consultation with RBI, RBI recommended government, sir, you are making mistake. Sorry, madam, you are making mistake. So now it is madam instead of sir. So government was compelled to introduce few more exceptions. 2 more exceptions as per central government notification number 80 of 2009, dated 15th October 19, but this was approved later. Okay, no TDS under 194N in case of cash withdrawal by following 2 more people subject to some conditions as recommended by RBI. Number 1, any authorized dealer means foreign currency dealer and his franchisee agent and sub agent. Foreign currency dealer, that is money changer or authorized dealer, his franchisee agent and franchisee sub-agents. Authorized dealer, its franchisee agent or sub-agent. And number 2, full-fledged money changer. Full-fledged money changer licensed by RBI. Both of them, in my opinion, are same only, but somebody who is only not an authorized dealer of foreign currency is just a money changer, then all. Provided. 2 extra condition fulfilled. Number 1, these 2 people maintain a separate bank account for these kind of dealings. And secondly, when they are withdrawing from that bank account exceeding 1 crore in cash, they will have to furnish a certificate to the bank that we are so and so, we are exempted, we have complied with all the conditions and the withdrawal is for so and so purpose only. 2 condition. Number 1, first condition, and its franchisee, provided such persons maintain a separate bank account from which withdrawal is made only and only for the purpose of purchase of foreign currency from non-residents, foreign tourists, non-residents visiting India, or from residents who are returning back from abroad, returning back to India. While purchasing currency from these people, if payment is made in Indian rupees, then withdrawals are made exceeding 1 crore rupees, not at a time, 1 crore is for the whole year. Then no TDS will be deductible under 194N, and even if tax is deducted, nothing to worry, credit will be available, but no TDS to be applied on these two people, provided these people maintain separate bank account for such activity, for withdrawing cash, and cash is withdrawn for making payment to these people, or in cash, or the payment is, or the amount is withdrawn for disbursement of inward remittance, disbursement of inward remittances to the recipient beneficiaries in India in cash under Money Transfer Service Scheme, MTSS of RBI. Or what is this? Separate bank account is maintained only for withdrawal, and whatever is inward remittance in that bank account, it is withdrawn and given to beneficial recipients. This is like Western Union money transfer. Western Union money transfer. They are not actually, they are money changers and authorized dealers also, but here they are not exchanging. They are not, it's not a foreign tourist coming to them and paying them dollar and these people give Indian currency. Anybody from US, your family member is staying in US, wants to make a wired transfer to your family member. You want to make transfer of funds. You have remitted $1,000. So your Indian family member will receive 70,000 Indian rupees through Western Union money transfer or such authorized people. They provide this service, money transfer service. Or simply, internationally, it is a wired transfer. Wired transfer means online transfer, whereby you will hand over $1,000 to Western Union money transfer in US, and Western Union money transfer ka Indian branch will give 70,000 Indian rupees to your family member. So Western Union money transfer, they will, in the Indian branch, they will withdraw cash from their bank account and give it to your family member. Then TDS under 194N will not apply if they maintain a separate bank account. Separate bank account for what purpose? For disbursement of remittances, disbursement of inward remittance. Who has made inward remittance? Inward remittance for Western Union money transfer. You have transferred to Western Union money transfer. In their bank account, they have received $1,000. And whatever for them is, whatever is inward remittance for them, they are disbursing the same to the recipient beneficiaries in India. Who are the recipient beneficiaries? Your family member. Samjha, did you all understand this? And also provided such persons furnish a certificate. Second condition. First condition, they maintain separate bank account. Second, they furnish certificate to the bank that the withdrawal is only for the purpose specified above, and RBI direction guidelines have been adhered to. Okay, that kind of certificate will have to be prescribed. And now Nirmala Sitharaman will prescribe the form number for this. Form number has not yet been prescribed. When will she do it? Nobody knows. People are waiting eagerly here. Cups, when will she specify? You know, gradually, dhige dhige karke. It's like you go to a restaurant and you order for food. Along with food, you order for some drink. Plus you order for salad. Plus you order for dessert. Plus you order for papad. So papad comes last. Papad, which should come along with the food, papad is served to you at the end. Okay, the restaurant people should have the sense that papad should come along with the food. That's a basic sense. Even if a person who starts a new restaurant, even if it is the first year, then also that much basic sense should be there. But that is where it is going in a haywire order. Okay, this is over. 194N is done. Now onwards, we have to start with wherever we stopped in the last session. Bank was supposed to deduct. See, what is happening is, you are Moise, right? You are Mr. M. Moise. You are staying in USA. You want to transfer money to your brother who's a rank holder. Okay. You will give it to, you are in USA. Suppose any, you did not get a rank, but you are minting money. Your brother got a rank, but he is earning less than you, hypothetically. Sara kameena aadmi feeling so excited. Yes, yes. You don't want to get a rank, but you want to earn more. Suppose you earn $1 crore. And you want to transfer some, you know, $1 lakh to your brother in India. So you will go to Western Union money transfer. You will deposit $1 lakh to him. US branch. They will transfer online to their Mumbai branch. Western Union money transfer Mumbai branch or Indian branch, India. It will be deposited from this bank account to this bank account of Western Union money transfer in India. From bank, they will withdraw. They will, local staff will withdraw and give it to your brother or your family member. Family member in India. they are withdrawing from bank. The bank was to deduct TDS 2% if the withdrawal exceeded 1 crore in the whole year. But bank will not be withdrawing provided these people maintain separate account for this activity and they furnish certificate to their bank that we are withdrawing for this purpose. The money which we have withdrawn is this inward remittance and that is meant for disbursement to the beneficiaries, disbursement to the recipient beneficiaries in India. Amount is inward remittance from abroad and that is meant for disbursement to beneficiaries in India. Beneficiary is your brother. Bank. Nay, they are not a bank. Their money is not transferred directly by them. The money actually goes from bank account. The Western Union money transfer USA, they will have a bank account with Citibank. Citi. Which account? Correct. Nostro account. So money is transferred by Citibank USA to Citibank India. Citibank India bank account. Citibank India. And Citibank India bank account belongs to Western Union Money Transfer India. They will withdraw from Citibank cash and they will give it to your family member. So when they are withdrawing from bank, bank is supposed to deduct 194 NMA 2% TDS if the withdrawals exceed 1 crore for the whole year. Citibank or whichever bank it is, they will not deduct. Two conditions fulfill. WUMT has maintained separate account, separate bank account for this activity. This is the out of India. That we are not concerned with. The bank account in India. So if they are engaged in other activities also, for other activities separate bank account and for this activity separate bank account. Secondly, they will have to furnish certificate to the bank that please don't deduct TDS. We are certifying, you know, like 15G, 15H, that kind of form or declaration that we are withdrawing for this purpose. So please don't deduct TDS. Clear? Authorized dealers and full-fledged money changers, FFMC. Money changer, MC means money changer. Don't look at him, look at me like that. It's not a bad word. Achha, you're copying this. Is FFMC, full-fledged MC, money changer. Achha, one more change has been made apart from these three chapters in transfer pricing chapter. Transfer pricing chapter, if you recollect, there was a concept of secondary adjustment, primary and secondary. Secondary adjustment means whatever additions are made by AO in the income of associated enterprise in India, that addition will be called as excess money. Excess money will have to be repatriated back to India. Making addition is called primary adjustment, and that whatever primary adjustments are made, that is called excess money. Excess money has to be brought back to India within 90 days, repatriated back to India within 90 days. Otherwise, interest will be charged. Rate of interest will be either State Bank of India rate, SBI marginal cost of fund lending rate on 1st April of the year plus 3.25%. If the transaction, international transaction is denominated in Indian currency, if the international transaction is denominated in foreign currency, then the rate will be LIBOR as on 30th September of the relevant year, LIBOR plus 3%. Do you remember? Okay. Now, major change has been made by CBDT. CBDT is also, you know, family member of Arun Jaitley and Nirmala Sitaraman. They very much in a hurry, they introduced Rule 10 CB. Rule 10 CB was introduced, computation of interest income pursuant to secondary adjustment. Now, this 90 days to be computed from which day, that was clarified. Okay, this you will find in a new sheet. This will not be there in the old sheet because old sheet may, this amendment, this was not there only. In case you are having two sheets of amendment. Video recorded lecture students will be having only one sheet, latest one fully updated. Local students have two sheets, so I've already incorporated the changes. Acha. So, acha, do you remember this? Primary adjustments could be made under five situations. Five situations. Ek second, I'll just explain it to you. I'll go backwards. And last time we discussed what is primary adjustment. So whatever additions are made by AO, suppose this is Indian associated enterprise, this is associated enterprise outside India. Indian associated enterprise had declared income of 1 crore. As per transfer pricing rules, 110 is the ALP. AO recomputes the income to be 101 crore. Addition of 100 crore is made. This addition is to be called primary adjustment. This process is called primary adjustment. And that 100 crore is to be called as excess money. Excess money is lying with, not only addition will be made, assessee will be required to pay tax on this 100 crore, plus penalty, plus interest, plus surcharge, health and education says, tax though will have to be paid, plus in addition to that, we discussed this time, last time that, assessee has an option to not to repatriate and pay additional tax at 18%. Do you remember? 18% plus compulsory surcharge 12%, 20.2996 or something was the rate, effective rate. Okay, not only that, this money is lying with associated enterprise. This will have to be repatriated back to India within 90 days. I mean, 90 days from where? So it was clarified that primary adjustment could have been made in 5 different situations. Which 5 situation? Primary adjustment could be made by assessee himself, suo moto, or primary adjustment is made by assessing officer and accepted by assessee, or primary adjustments are made as per APA rules, advance pricing agreement rules, under section 92CC, or it is made as per safe harbor rules under section 92CB, or primary adjustment are made as per resolution to assessment as per mutual agreement procedure MAP between two countries. Assessee on his own, suo moto, made by AO, accepted by assessee as per APA rules, as per safe harbor rules, or as per MAP. APA rules, safe harbor rule, MAP. First two, assessee makes or AO makes. Acha. Now, time limit to bring it back to India was generally 90 days from the due date of filing IT return. Now, government had forgotten to clarify, even CBDT also forgot to clarify that 90 days samjha, but interest will be from which day? Interest will be computed from which day? So logically everyone thought that interest will start from 91st day after expiry of 90 days. No. Now CBDT clarified by issuing some notification. No, interest just like TDS chapter, Do you remember TDS chapter mein the deducted tax has to be deposited by 7th of the next month, but interest will not start from 8th of the next month. It will start from the date on which tax was deductible. Exactly same concept. Interest will not start from 91st day. Interest will start from the same time limit wherever 90 days were to be computed from. Second amendment made, in fact, new circular issued. Okay. First of all, 92 CE mein whatever. This amendment we already discussed. In case if primary adjustments are determined by assessee, suo moto, by AO, accepted by assessee. Third point was determined as per APA. APA rules, but usme some small change made, provided such is determined as per APA rules on or after 1st April 17, but with retrospective effect from AY 1890, meaning thereby this amendment made right now, but applicable from the beginning, ever since this concept was introduced. Secondly, in secondary adjustment, the amount which was to be brought back, up till now it was written that excess money has to be brought back. Then amendment was made, not only excess money or a part thereof, whatever you bring. Okay, then for the removal of doubts, amendment we already discussed last time that for the removal of doubts has been clarified and repatriation need not be from the same associated enterprise with whom transaction was carried out. Repatriation could be from any non-resident associated enterprise. Explanation. Introduced by Finance Act 19, but with retrospective effect from AY 1819, that it could be brought back from any non-resident associated enterprise and need not be from the same non-resident associated enterprise with whom international transaction was carried out. The international transaction was carried out with Y Limited, but the money can be brought back, repatriated to India from Q Limited, R Limited, any non-resident associated enterprise. Okay, another amendment made, proviso to section 92 CE. Which talks about two exceptions, that the concept of secondary adjustment will not apply in case where primary adjustment was made, primary adjustment amount does not exceed 1 crore, and secondly, primary adjustment it was made up to AY 1617, that was before AY 1718. Small amendment carried out, everyone look up here. What were the two exceptional cases where primary adjustment concept or secondary adjustment will not apply? No need to repatriate back within 90 days, excess money. If primary adjustments in any previous year does not exceed 1 crore. And second was, it was made prior to AY 1780. Between these two exceptions, government by mistake used the word and. One and two. But they did not mean and. That does not mean both the conditions should be fulfilled. The primary adjustment should be before AY 1718 plus it should not exceed 1 crore. It is 1 or 2. So this I had already explained you while discussing this chapter. this particular concept, but government has officially deleted the word and replaced it by or. Okay. Rule 10 CB by major amendment has been made. Computation of interest income pursuant to secondary adjustment. Rule 10 CB subrule 1 has been totally revamped. 90 days from where? So what did we study earlier? There were 5 situations where primary adjustment could have been made. Suo moto by assessee, made by AO, accepted by assessee, as per APA rules, as per safe harbor rules, as per MAP. By what date, what time limit the money was to be repatriated back to India? 90 days from the due date of filing IT return if primary adjustments were made by assessee himself. Or from the date of AO's order, from the date of order of AO, or from the date of order of appellate authority in case where primary adjustments were made by AO or primary adjustments were made by appellate authority and assessee did not challenge further. Assessee accepted it and accepted by assessee. So only in this second point, the time limit of 90 days was to start from AO's order or appellate authority's order. Everywhere else, the time limit of 90 days was to start from the due date of IT return. Third, if the primary adjustments are made as per APA rules, then also time limit to repatriate it back was due date 90 days from the due date of filing IT return. Again, 90 days from the due date of filing IT return if primary adjustments were made as per safe harbor rules. And again, same thing, 90 days from the due date of filing IT return in case primary adjustments were made as per mutual agreement procedure, MAP, under DTAA, clear? So everywhere time limit to repatriate was 90 days from the due date of filing IT return, everywhere, except of second point where 90 days from the date of order of AO. Everywhere it was due date of 139.1. Okay, now it's been drastically changed, entirely changed. CBDT notification so and so 30th September 19, dated 30th September 19. Now time limits are also changed, and one more time limit is inserted. Third column is newly inserted. Third column is, which was not there last time, third column is 90 days though will be computed from here and interest will be computed from which day. So different situation, everyone look up your case, which situation is it. Second column, time limit for repatriation of excess money or a part thereof within 90 days from so and so date, from the following date. 90 days earlier were majority places were to be computed from the due date of filing IT return. Now it's been changed. Last column, newly introduced, third column, date from which interest is to be computed on non-repatriated excess money or part thereof within specified time. If not repatriated, within specified time. Third column is newly introduced, and second column, existing time limit has been slightly changed. First scenario, first column, second column, third column. Which is the first situation? If primary adjustments are made by assessee suo moto, have been made suo moto by the assessee. What was the time limit to bring it back? 90 days from where? Due date of filing IT. Here no changes are made. This has been kept intact. 90 days to be counted from the due date of filing ROI as given in 139.1. But interest was to be computed from which date? So it was believed that interest will be from 91st day. In the absence of clarification, answer no, interest is also to be counted from the same day, that is from the due date of filing ROI given under 139.1. Whatever is written in italics, that is newly inserted, that is new or it is different. Clear about this? First situation, 90 days wala time limit has been kept intact, but interest calculation wala time limit has been newly introduced, just like TDS. Which is the second scenario? In case where primary adjustments are made as per order of AO, determined as per the order of AO, or determined as per order of appellate authority and has been accepted by assessee. AO's order accepted by assessee means assessee did not file further appeal, did not file appeal at all. And appellate authority's order is accepted by assessee means assessee did not file further appeal. So 90 days were to be counted from which day? From the date of order of AO or date of order of appellate authority. That has been kept intact. The date of said order of AO or order of appellate authority. Here again changes were necessitated, still changes required. What was the change last time? If you recollect while discussing this chapter, we had discussed that here government or CBDT has failed to clarify. This kind of situation has arisen many a times in past. Every time matter goes into the court, date of order of AO means which date? The date of passing the order or the date on which assessee receives the copy of order. It is always to be understood as date on which assessee's assessee receives the copy of order. But CBDT should always clarify, this is the mistake, same mistake very repeatedly made by CBDT again and again. These idiot anguta chap people, illiterate people, there have been so many cases in past, and the High Court always instructs them, why don't you maintain transparency from the beginning? Why the matter comes up to us for small petty things? However, what will be the time limit to compute interest? Time limit to compute the interest will be the date of said order of AO or the date of appellate authority. Same date. But it was not there earlier, so this, the newly introduced. Which is the third situation, primary adjustments are made as per APA rules. APA rules, now here the problem was, what was the earlier due date? 90 days were to be computed from the due date of filing IT return. Due date of filing IT return for the relevant year for which primary adjustments were made. The people ask the question, okay, sir, if primary adjustments are going to be made, if you recollect APMA, there was a concept, APA is valid for maximum 5 years, but a rollback is also there, backwards 4 years, total 9 years possible. So with regards to rollback years, what was the time limit earlier if the primary adjustments were made as per APA rules? Due date of filing IT return. So people say, sir, what about the 4 rollback years? The due date of filing IT return for the earliest possible year, 4th year, the first year out of 4 years, would have fallen due in 2nd year. Primary adjustments are made in the current year. Current year is the 6th year. So you'll charge me interest for so many years unnecessarily. You should give me some time to repatriate. 90 days you are counting from the due date of 1st year. And today is the 6th year. The rollback may, I would end up paying interest for 3, 4 years unnecessarily. The CBDT changed it. Okay, sorry, our mistake. They did not say rollback years. They split this situation into two parts. Understand very clearly. First situation, that is clause A, clause B. Clause A says, if the APA has been already entered into before the due date of filing IT return. And second situation, APA has been entered into after the due date of filing IT return. Let us understand. Everyone look up here. Year 1, 2, 3, 4. These 4 years are going to be under rollback. APA has been entered into in year 5 with CBDT, APA. And APA is going to be applicable for year 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 years APA is going to be applicable. When is the APA entered into? APA has been entered into in the 5th year. Supposing it is entered into on 5th year. It is entered into on 11th December of the year 5. Year 5. 11th December of year 5. So, for which years it will be called as the APA has been entered into after the due date of filing IT return? For which years the APA has been entered into after the due date, and for which years it is before the due date, on or before the due date? So, if agreement has been entered into with CBDT on 11 December of year 5, then for year 5 ka IT return due date will be in year 6. So as far as year 5 is concerned, the agreement has been entered into before the due date of IT return or after the due date of filing IT return? Are you all understanding? Before ke after? Before. For year 6, 7, 8 and 9, all the 5 years, the agreement has been entered into before the due date of filing IT return. Are you understanding? For year 1, 2, 3, 4, for these 4 years, let's discuss for first 3 years, which are under rollback. Year 1, 2, 3, 4 are under rollback. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 are under normal APA. For year 1, IT return due date falls due in year 2. Year 2. Agreement has been entered into in year 5. So for year 1, APA has been entered into after the due date of year 1 or before the due date of year 1? After. Year 2 due date of IT return falls due in year 3. So for year 2 agreement has been entered into under rollback after the due date of IT return or before the due date? After. Year 3? After. Year 4? Year 4 ke liye bhi it is after. Year 4 ka IT return due date would be 30th November of year 5. 30th November of year 5. If agreement is entered into on 11 December of year 5, then year 4 ke late is after. But if the agreement is entered into in year 5 on 11th November 2 of the year 5, 11th November, then year 4 would be before. Are you understanding? Okay. So earlier, what was the time limit to repatriate? 90 days from the due date of filing IT return. Due date of filing IT return. Now it's been changed. For these years, for which agreement has been entered into after the due date of filing IT return. Okay. Before the due date of filing IT return. For these years, 1 minute. Now you think about it logically and tell me what should be the rule. 90 days should be from which day? Now suppose any primary adjustment is made in the 8th year. 8th year. Agreement has been entered into in year 5. Primary adjustments have been made as per APA rules for year 8. So here it should be 90 days from the due date of IT return. 90 days from the due date of IT return for all the 5 years. All these 5 years, old rule will continue to be applicable. 90 days will be from the due date of IT return. Practically, changes have been made for these years, for first 4 years, which fall under rollback. For these 4 years, what was the time limit earlier to repatriate? 90 days from the due date of filing IT return, which was wrong. Are you understanding why it was wrong? Now, what should be the new rule? 90 days should be from which date? Something relating to date of entering into APA. 90 days should be from the date of entering into APA or something relatable to APA. So answer is, for these 4 years, the due date, the time limit to repatriate, 90 days will be from the end of the month in which APA entered into. 90 days from the end of the month in which APA has been entered into. Either it should be 90 days from the date of APA or 90 days from the end of the month in which APA has been entered into. CBDT has kept the time limit to be 90 days from the end of the month in which APA has been entered into. Coming back here. 1 minute, I forgot to turn off the light earlier. Huh. Now clarity is made. Abhi acha dikh raha hai? Camera to acha hi hai tumhara. Main wo doubt nahi kar raha hun. Mera dikhta acha hai abhi lights off. Brightness level. Okay, so now this point has been split into two parts. Number one, if the APA has been entered into on or before the due date of filing IT return of the relevant previous year. APA has been entered into on or before the due date of filing IT return. Which years are we talking about? Out of 9 years. Year number 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Year 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. What was the rule earlier? Time 90 days were from the due date of filing IT return. That has been continued. 90 days from the, sorry, that's been slightly changed. Sorry, not due date, but actual date of filing the return of income. 90 days from the actual date of filing the return. Instead of due date of filing IT return. Bold italic is the change. This will be interest to be counted from which date? The interest will be counted from the actual date of filing the return. Okay, 90 days from the actual date, but interest to be counted from the due date of filing IT return. Here it is different, therefore I have highlighted it. 90 days to be counted from the actual date of filing return, but interest shall be calculated from the due date of filing IT return. Are you clear? Okay. This is again technically wrong. Technically, all these places, earlier also it was wrong, now also it's wrong. Technically, calculation should not be from the due date of IT return or so and so. Calculation should be from the next day onwards. If IT return due date is 30th November, the calculation ideally should start from 1st December. 1st December, next day onwards. But as per the language use, calculation will start from the 30th November itself, whatever is the due date. And now for rollback years, that means APA has been entered into. We don't say rollback. Instead of rollback, what language has been used to describe rollback years? If APA has been entered into after the due date of filing IT return of the relevant previous year. So this will be applicable for which years? This will be applicable for rollback years. Are you understanding? Rollback year. Now for rollback years, we cannot say 90 days from the due date of filing IT return or actual date of filing IT return. Otherwise, assessee will end up paying interest for 3-4 years unnecessarily, which is wrong. So now 90 days will be counted from which? From the end of the month in which APA has been entered into. Bold italic is a total change. Earlier, what was the rule? Here also, it had to be 90 days from the due date of filing IT return. Now it's been changed to 90 days from the end of the month in which APA has been entered into. Government CBDT had two options, either to keep 90 days from the date of entering APA or 90 days from the end of the month in which APA entered into. Which one they selected? 90 days from the end of the month in which APA entered into. Interest will be counted from which date? So interest will also be from the end of the month, 90 days, the end of the month in which APA has been entered into. 90 days also to be counted from the same day, and interest will also start from the same day. Just like TDS, interest will not start from 91st day, interest will start from, so 90 days given are grace period basically. Clear? Last two situation where changes have not been made except of introduction of third column. Fourth situation where the option has been exercised for safe harbor by SSE as per safe harbor rule under section 92 CB. Then earlier what was the rule? 90 days were to be counted from the due date of filing IT return. Now also it is still same only, the due date of filing ROI given in 139.1. But interest will be from which day? That was not calculated, that was not specified. So people thought 91st day, but 91st day nahi, interest will also commence from the same day, the due date of filing ROI under 139.1. Repatriation time limit also is from the same day, and if not repatriated back, then interest will also start from the same day and not from 91st day. Last situation where primary adjustments are made as per to transfer price is determined by a resolution arrived at under mutual agreement procedure. MAP under DTAA under section 1990. Here also no here major change has been made. What was the time limit? 90 days from which day it was? Here also it was 90 days from the due date of filing IT return. Due date of filing IT return. But then government realized that here due date, CBDT realized that due date is a wrong term, due date of IT return, because whatever is decided as per MAP may not be decided immediately. Decision as per MAP may take 3-4 years. It may take 3-4 years to decide, because it will be mutual agreement procedure between competent authorities of two countries. It will take 3-4 years. So it is a story of year one in which primary adjustments are made. Assessment is completed in year two. Year three may SSE applied for SSE complaint to the competent authority of respective country that this is wrong. Accordingly, till year 4 and year 5, competent authority is not able to decide. Year 6 may competent authority of India will communicate with competent authority of foreign country of which SSE is resident or whatever. Then in year 7, mutual agreement procedure will take place. Year 7 may mutual agreement procedure takes place. Year 8 may it may be decided. It takes very long time, 8th year. And then in the 9th year, after this resolution is received under MAP, copy will be forwarded to AO. AO has to give effect to that MAPCA resolution within 45 days. Within 45 days from the date of receipt. So this is going to, here primary adjustment would practically be made in the 8th or the 9th year. 9th year mein adjustments are made primary. And you start charging interest to SSE from the due date of first year's IT return, which falls due in second year. So second year se leke 9th year tak you keep charging interest to him, which is wrong. You can't give him 90 days from the due date of filing IT return. CBDT now realized that they changed it. Time limit for 90 days to repatriate will be starting with the date on which AO gives effect, date of giving effect of mutual agreement procedure by AO as per rule 44H by the AO. Date of giving effect by the AO under rule 44H to such resolution, and 90 days also to be counted from the date of AO passing the order or giving effect to MAP, and interest will also be computed from the same date, the date of giving effect by AO under rule 44H to such resolution. AO has to pass order giving effect. AO has to pass order if you recollect this chapter called, this is not there in your syllabus in paper 7. This is covered in paper 6E Model Tax Convention. Model Tax Convention, whereby it is given that AO will have to give effect to whatever is the resolution of MAP. As per MAP, AO will have to give effect within 45 days. Provided SSE accepts the resolution as per MAP and SSE is ready to withdraw all the appeals, whatever is pending, then MAP will be applied by AO by passing new assessment order. And it is given in Article 25 of Model Tax Convention, in case you have opted for Paper 6E, you have opted, right? So Paper 6E Model Tax Convention, it is given map effect will be given by AO within 45 days, provided assessee accepts the map resolution. Provided assessee gives it in writing that is acceptable to him, then only AO will give effect within 45 days, irrespective of the time limit given in the domestic law. So even if the domestic law says that time limit to pass order by AO is 1 year from the end of the assessment year, or time limit to reopen and give effect is 6 years from the end of the assessment year, ignoring those time limit, 45 days from the date of receipt of map resolution will be applicable. Nay. Within 45 days as per rule 44H, a assessee has to give acceptance of his resolution, and within 45, same time limit for all. So this also needs to be re-verified by government or CBDT. The time limit available to assessee to accept is also 45 days. Time limit for AO also is 45 days. Actually, there is no time limit for assessee. There is no time limit for assessee. But if assessee does not give acceptance, time limit is not mentioned only for assessee to accept or reject. Correct. And it's been clarified in rule 44H that assessee, there is no time limit, but if assessee does not accept, does not send his acceptance, then it will be deemed that it is not acceptable to assessee. And then map will become redundant. And in that case, what will happen? Paper 6C. Don't go deeper into it. Okay. Obviously, then, you know, everything is to be taught in paper 7, then what will paper 6C people do? They paid me extra fees for that. Okay. What? I gave you discount. Interest. Annual basis interest to be computed. In case transaction is in Indian currency, to State Bank ka MCFLR plus 3.25%. State Bank ka MCFLR as on 1st April of the relevant previous year. This is not covered in the amendment because there is no change here. I'm just explaining it. In case the international transaction was expressed or denominated in foreign currency, the rate of interest will be LIBOR as on 30th September of the relevant previous year plus 3%. 18% tax, huh? No time limit. 18% additional tax file option on excess money which has not been repatriated, one can exercise anytime. The moment assessee pays the tax, additional tax, plus compulsory surcharge 10%, moment assessee pays, this interest will stop. Till then, interest will continue. Right. So suppose any interest starts from particular date, if not repatriated within 90 days. You did not repatriate for 2-3 years, and third year you decided to pay additional tax 18%, then the moment you pay, this interest will stop. In the intervening period of those 3 years, interest will continue. Are you clear with this? Nay. So the time limit will be here. The time limit will be due date of filing IT return, irrespective of the date on which assessee files, except of the second situation where time limit 90 days is from the actual date of filing the return. So the actual date could be belated also. Huh. 139, must be 139, but CBDT has printed it as, typed it as 139.1 only, which is wrong. These people, they constantly keep on making mistake. Okay, any which ways, one more amendment, rate of interest you know pretty well. Now, Kinjal, what in case the transaction is denominated in foreign currency and we have to charge this interest, whatever is the rate of interest, LIBOR plus 3%, then that foreign currency value of the transaction, excess money will have to be converted into Indian rupees, or that whatever is the interest, that will have to be converted into Indian rupees. So clarification inserted by CBDT, note, if the international transaction has been undertaken in foreign currency, then the rate of conversion of the value of international transaction into Indian rupees shall be buying telegraphic transfer rate, TT rate of State Bank of India. As on which day? So as on the last day of the previous year in which international transaction was undertaken. Okay. Now this interest is to be computed every year. Interest is to be computed every year on the excess money till the time it is repatriated. If not repatriated at all, then interest, notional interest will continue lifetime. But notional interest, rate of interest may change every year, because rate of interest will be LIBOR or state bank rate plus so and so percentage. LIBOR or state bank rate of interest may change every year. New rate may have to be applied, but principal amount on which the interest is to be charged will be fixed up because of this amendment. Now that principal amount which is in foreign currency will be converted into Indian currency, applying not the rate every year, applying one particular rate, rate TT buying rate as on last day of the previous year in which international transaction was undertaken. Meaning thereby, if interest continues, notional interest for 3 years, the rate of interest in all the 3 years will be different. Rate of interest will be different, but the principal amount on which interest is to be computed, principal amount in Indian rupees will remain same, because we don't have to take the rate as on last day of each and every previous year. We have to take into account rate of conversion, TT buying rate, as on the last day of that previous year in which international transaction was undertaken. Why you look so confused? Huh? Okay, international transaction is undertaken in year one, and 90 days is from the due date of filing IT return supposedly, which falls due in year two. So interest will start from year two, somewhere in year two, for maybe 30th November of year two. Supposing not repatriated back, so year three also interest will be charged. Interest will be calculated and interest will be added to the income. Year four, year five also. Now that means interest is going to be charged, or in notional interest is to be added to the income of year 2, year 3, year 4, year 5 till the time not repatriated by. Till the time repatriated by. What will be the rate of interest? Rate of interest would be different if it is in foreign currency, LIBOR plus 3.25. LIBOR may keep changing every year. LIBOR this year is 5%, next year it is 4.5%, next year it is 4.75%. Rate of interest will keep changing. But the amount on which interest is to be charged, that is excess money will be in foreign currency because transaction is in foreign currency. So excess money on which interest is to be calculated, notional interest, that will be converted applying only one particular rate. That amount, suppose any, the transaction is undertaken in year one, transaction is $82,53,384 US dollars. 82,53,000. Into which rate would you apply? Rate prevailing converted into 31st March of year 1. Correct. 31st March of year 1. The year, last day of the year in which transaction took place. Once it is converted into Indian rupees, that amount gets fixed up. So as on that day, the dollar rate was 40. Now year 2 may dollar rate is 50, year 3 may it is 60, year 4 may it is 70, year 4 may dollar, 5 may dollar rate is 80. Don't apply all these rate. Principal amount converted from foreign currency to Indian currency on which interest is to be computed gets fixed up. This clarification should have been inserted long back. But these people have literally tube light, you know, these people wake up. Again, furthermore changes are required. This is actually favoring SSE. This is favoring SSE. That the money gets up in terms of Indian rupees amount gets fixed up. Clear about this? Unimportant point, not so relevant from exam perspective. This is applicable only when transaction was denominated, international transaction was denominated in foreign currency. If it was in an Indian currency, then this rule will not apply. CBDT notification 30th September 2019. Following four new subsections were introduced that we already discussed about additional tax at 18% on excess money, effective rate with 12% compulsory surcharge would be 20.9664. This we already discussed. No need to make secondary adjustment once this additional tax is paid, and no need to compute interest also. And whatever is paid, notional interest calculation will stop from the date of payment of additional tax. And the amount of additional tax paid will neither be considered as advance tax, nor is it TDS, nor is it anything. No credit, no refund, nothing will be allowed. One time payment, gone. Okay, this is over. Okay, now next is amendments made in assessment of public charitable trust chapter. Public charitable and religious trust or institution. These are very simple amendments. Now onwards amendments will not require any further or detailed clarification. They are very simple. If you recollect the procedure for registration, the trust would apply to CIT or PCIT in a prescribed form 10A along with further documents. CIT would call for further documents by issuing notice. CIT satisfied, then he will pass order granting registration. CIT not satisfied, he will pass order refusing to grant registration. Refusal order appealable, if you recollect charitable trust. Now, what exactly CIT had to be satisfied for? CIT could make inquiries from outsiders also. CIT had to be satisfied about two things to grant registration. CIT had to be satisfied about the genuineness of the activities of the trust and genuineness of the objects of the trust. Genuineness of activities, genuineness of the objects. Apart from that, one more item added. CIT will have to be satisfied about the genuineness of the activities, genuineness of the objects of the trust, and also with effect from 1st September 19, CIT should be satisfied for granting registration about the compliance by the trust or institution, compliance by the trust of the requirements under any other law which is a must, which is necessary for the time being in force, which are material for the purpose of achieving its objects. For the purpose of achieving its objects. Like what exactly is this? Yes, compliance with the Indian Trust Act, that is the must. So they will, trust will have to register itself under Indian Trust Act or with Charity Commissioner, that is a must. Not only that, one more thing, if you as a trust apply to CIT that you want to set up an educational trust, your objective is to set up a school, the first you arrange for trustees, create the trust, execute trust deed, go to Charity Commissioner, register your trust. Before you come to Commissioner of Income Tax, also apply for school eligibility certificate. School setting up, and supposing you want to set up an ICSE school, you get a certificate or get the permission from ICSE board. Okay, this rule was introduced basically for two things, mainly in Gujarat. One very big school which was running CBSE school without permission from CBSE board, NCRT, without NCRT permission, they had 1200 students studying in that school from 1st standard to 10th standard. They were successfully running the school. And then the main trustee was some sadhu, some Baba, Nityanand Baba or something. He was caught for some molestation allegations, and some two children died also. The dead bodies were not found, something like that. And that is how the thing started. Lot of inquiry, like Asaram Bapu inquiries. And then finally it came to their knowledge that Baba was absconding. Then those children were also not found, and there were a lot of other allegations also. Then finally government shut down the school, or government has given deadline of 31st March 20. Till 31st March 20 school will continue. So now onwards rules are made, and now onwards as a trust, if you want to set up a school, we will not grant you income tax exemption unless you have got permission to run the school. So first you take the register your trust with Charity Commissioner, take the permission to run the school, then after you last may come to CIT. One more trust set up by something between you and me, Rahul Gandhi, he set up one trust called Young India, and he had also not taken some permission, and a trust is going on since past 5-6 years. Still he has not obtained some requisite permission to under particular law to carry out the activities for which the trust is set up. So such kind of trust registration will be cancelled. Not only this, one more item added, one more similar condition. Are you clear? So now before granting registration, CIT has to be satisfied about the genuineness of the objects of the trust, activities of the trust, and also about the CIT should be satisfied about the compliance by the trust of any other law, requirement under other law. Next, in case he is satisfied about the genuineness of the activities and about the compliance of the, if he satisfied that compliance of the requirements under other law, then he shall pass an order in writing registering the trust. If he is not satisfied, he shall pass order refusing to register. Here also one more item added. This is same as earlier one. And now if you recollect section 12AA subsection 3 subsection 4, cancellation of registration. Even in cancellation, 85% something that 85% had to be spent, those conditions for there. Acha, now one more thing I would like to bring to your notice, especially those who studied under me in May 19 and November 19 attempt. There has always been a confusion whether it should be 85% of gross income or net income. So if you recollect, we had discussed it shall be 15%, 85% of the net income. However, there was a Supreme Court decision in the year 2001 that it should be 85 and 15% of the gross income. It should be of the gross income. Our institute had not been following this Supreme Court decision of 2001. Our institute had not been following this decision till now. Our institute has now started following this decision since May 19, November 19 attempt, and I think November 18 attempt also. Now since institute has started following, institute has changed the answers of all the questions now, so we will also change. It shall be 85% of net income. That is what I taught you, even in my notes also, in the earlier notes. It was net income, gross income minus direct expenses. That is what net income. And all other expenses, admin expenditure, income tax paid, etc. would be below the line, will be considered as 85%. This is not to be followed any further. As per Supreme Court ruling in case of CIT versus Program for Community Organization 2001, in case you had been doing this way only, to no worries, I'm following whatever institute says. If you want marks, you blindly follow institute, right or wrong, that is secondary thing. 15%, it shall be 15% of gross receipts or gross income would be eligible for accumulation. And accordingly, if charitable trust has got gross income of 140 lakh, example, understand, gross income of 140 lakh, direct expenses of 40 lakhs, and the amount applied towards object is 79 lakh. Gross income 140, expenditure 40, net income 100 lakhs, amount applied towards approved object is 79 lakh. So what were we doing up till now? Which institute was also doing? I'm following institute. Huh? Whatever institute says that you follow, right or wrong is a secondary. What institute had been doing? Institute had been taking 15%, 85% of net income. So step number one, we used to do this way. Gross income 140 lakh minus direct expenditure 40 lakh, net income 100 lakh, 100 lakh of 15% you subtract, 15% of net income is 15 lakh, balance is 85 lakh. From 85 lakh, which reflects 85% of income, less you subtract amount applied towards approved object, which is how much? 79 lakh. Accordingly, 6 lakhs would be taxable income. This is what we had been doing, net income ka. This is less beneficial to the assessee. Supreme Court decision says take 15%, 85% of gross income. That is more beneficial for the assessee. This I had explained you at that time also, those who were present. Second situation, in case we take 15% of gross income. If we take 15% of gross income is 140. 140 minus 15% of 140 would be 21 lakhs. 21 lakh. Net income would be, again, amount required to be applied towards approved object will be 119. 119 minus expenses also 40 lakhs, that also you will subtract now, and amount applied towards approved object also to be subtracted now. Both of them you will subtract. You will say direct expenses 40 lakh, balance is 79. 79 is required to be applied towards approved object. Amount applied towards approved object directly is 79. Taxable income would be nil. Nay. Of 140. This is it. So now you will have to do it this way. So what institute has done, in module, these people, they played a trick. Till last year, they had kept questions this way. They were still doing this way. Then, sorry, last year, November 19 attempt onwards, institute has removed all the questions wherever there are direct expenses. Direct expense wala questions only they have removed. Totally, in the whole module. There's not a single question where there are expenses involved. They straight away will give you this. Income is 140, amount applied is 79. And then some anonymous donation. This matter will not, because institute still does not agree with Supreme Court decision. I also don't agree with Supreme Court decision. I feel, with all due respect to Supreme Court judge, I personally feel Supreme Court requires reconsideration. This is totally wrong. Bullshit it is. Nonsense. Why, I will tell you. How can anyone set apart 15% of something which is not there in their pocket? Suppose any, just imagine, 140 is income. Suppose any expenses were 100, expenses were 100, net income was 40, means how much trust is having in his pocket? 40 lakh. How can they spend 85% of 140 lakh? How can anybody apply 85% of something which they don't have in their pocket? It has to be 15 or 85% of amount available in the pocket, available for application. Expenses are different, application of income is different. Do you agree with that? Expenses is something which you incur for earning the income, and application of income is something which you do from the net income after earning the income. Are you understanding? So in such situation, it logically speaking, it should be this way only, but Supreme Court has done this. Our institute had not been following this. All of a sudden institute has started following this particular thing, 15% of gross income. You also switch over, otherwise marks will be deducted. What is to be done now? This. You can click the picture of this if you want to. This is not an amendment, but it is the change made by institute. You follow institute if you want marks. Clear? Okay, next. With all due respect to the above pronouncement of Apex Court, which is in favor of the assessor. Why institute has all of a sudden started following this? The institute has, you know, started following all those things which are beneficial to assessor. The institute says that Supreme Court decision is beneficial. As you could see here in the previous slide, if Supreme Court decision is beneficial, then follow it. Why not to follow? Other views more logical, and accordingly 15% of net income should be considered. But exam may, while solving the question, students are advised to claim 15% of grossing. So in the new books for May 20 and November 20 onwards, I am inserting this clarification that I don't agree with Supreme Court, but institute has started following it, so you also do it for exam purpose. And you can write a note if you want to. Right? Okay. Format also undergoes slight change as compared to the notes which you are having. We used to start with gross income excluding corpus donation. Gross income including business income, including capital gain, but excluding corpus donation. Because corpus is capital received, corpus is not taxable. Then what we were doing up till now, we were subtracting direct expenditure. Don't do that. Straight away, first subtract 15%. Balance will be 85%. From here you subtract expenses and everything. Direct expenses. Now direct expenses will be considered as application of income. Deficit of earlier years brought forward. Income not received during the year. Amount required to be applied toward approved object. Amount spent towards approved object actually spent in the current year or next year. If spent next year, provided AO has been informed in form number 9A that this much is spent next year. Less amount accumulated for spending in future. Are you able to recollect accumulation for spending in future? Maximum 5 years, can be renewed every 5 years. Provided AO has been informed in form number 10. Balance will be the taxable income. Please click the picture of this format, new format. This is what is to be done now. This is under 15%, 85% of gross income concept. Okay, now second amendment made is this. Achha, this is as per Supreme Court. Cancellation of registration. In the granting of registration also, the amendment that we checked out, same amendment is reproduced here. 12AA subsection 3 and subsection 4, cancellation of registration. Up till now, registration could be cancelled because of three things. CIT is, after granting registration, it comes to knowledge of CIT. Registration could be cancelled by CIT if it comes to his knowledge that activities of the trust are not genuine. Or number two, activities are in contravention of the objects. Objects are medical purpose and trust is selling alcohol. Trust is manufacturing alcohol, manufacturing gutka, and they are running hospital. So objects and activities, chalta hai, gutka is allowed, they can manufacture, nothing wrong. But objects and activities are contradicting, so that is not correct. That is not correct. Or activities of the trust are carried out in such a manner that exemption under section 11 and 12 is disallowed. Provisions of 11 and 12 section do not apply for that year as per 13(1). Newly introduced with effect from 1st September 19, registration can be cancelled. A new trust which now applies, to CIT will check whether trust has complied with the requirement under other law or not. Not complied, registration will not be granted. For existing trust which were already granted registration, Rahul Gandhi's trust, Young India, which is already granted registration, which has not complied with the requirement of law, other law up till now, unke liye registration will be cancelled. Of course, after giving opportunity of being heard. 1st September 19, the trust or institution has not complied with the requirements of any other law. And an order has been passed under that other law. An order or direction or decree by whatever name called has been passed under other law holding that non-compliance has occurred. Non-compliance has occurred, such kind of order has been passed under that other law. which has been either not disputed by associate trust or which has become final, which has attained finality. Don't go lengthy sentence. Simply, trust has failed. New trust, which is now applying, has not complied. The registration will not be granted. Existing trust, which has not complied till today, registration is there. The registration can be cancelled, but after giving opportunity of being heard, this is over. Okay. Now the next amendment is an assessment of political party. If you recollect, political party section 13A. According to section 13A, barring PGBP income, all the other incomes of political party are eligible for exemption if 5 conditions were fulfilled by political party. If you recollect, given in 13A, 5 conditions means the first condition, they compulsorily maintain books of accounts, compulsory maintain. Third condition, they get them audited. Second condition, they maintain records of each voluntary contribution exceeding 20,000, otherwise by way of electoral bonds, except by way of electoral bonds. That amendment we know. Okay. There is one more condition. Last condition was introduced recently, AY 1819. Last condition, IT return has to be filed compulsorily within due date. And the fourth condition was no donation exceeding 20,000 has been accepted by the political party. No donation exceeding 2,000 is accepted, otherwise by way of account payee check, account payee draft or ECS through a bank. I'm sure you must have understood what would be the amendment. Apart from these three modes, one more added from AY 2021 or through such other electronic mode as may be prescribed. Up till now, nothing has been prescribed. Whatever was prescribed, that UPI, Bheem UPI, RuPay card, that was specifically prescribed for 216 and SU. But I'm sure it's a mistake. Whatever they have specified for 216 and SU, that they actually want to specify for all other sections. But they have made a mistake. Anguda chapi. Or by way of electoral bonds. This was the only amendment. Political party is over. Now next one is electoral trust. Electoral trust, no amendment has been made. Assessment procedure chapter, couple of amendments have been made. As not today, we don't have that much time. Otherwise, I would have showed it to you five times. As many times you would have requested for, because you have paid fees and I did not give you discount. The wrong allegation which were put on me, because of that, I have to show you again and again. I'm sorry, but then after the lecture, I'll pakka show you. Right now, let's proceed. Assessment procedure chapter, procedure for assessment, very first section 139.1, filing of IT return. Who was required to file IT return? Do you recollect? IT returns were to be required to be filed by company mandatorily, partnership firm including LLP mandatorily, ROR having assets outside India or being beneficiary of assets outside India, etc., or bank account outside or signing or having signing authority in any bank any account outside India, etc. And last one was any other person other than the above if income exceeded basic exemption. Okay, couple of changes have been made, quite a few many changes. Interesting, relevant for MCQ purpose. MCQ, I'm strongly expecting. Company, partnership firm, they were mandatorily required. ROR having asset outside India or signing authority in any account outside India as a signing authority. These people, ABC plus one more. Last one was every other person other than the above. Every other person other than the above. Acha, one more item added, point number E, with effect three people are added. Which three people? Number one, person everywhere. Let me explain it to you. Anybody who deposits more than 1 crore rupees in current account, more than 1 crore rupees in bank account. Cash word is not used. Anybody who deposits in by any mode. Anybody who deposits more than 1 crore in current account will have to file IT return. Anybody who spends more than 2 lakh rupees on foreign travel for self or any other person in aggregate for the whole year. Spending more than 2 lakh rupees on foreign travel. And last, anybody whose electricity consumption bill for the whole year is more than 1 lakh rupees. Then that person will have to file IT return mandatorily. And then all these people will not be allowed to use that easy form ITR1, that Sahaj or what is called. That they will not be allowed to use. They have to file normal IT. Every person who during the previous year has deposited amount or aggregate of amounts or amounts exceeding 1 crore rupees in one or more current account, only current account with any bank or cooperative society engaged in banking business. post office people, post office banks don't have current account. They have only savings account. This is only for current account. Depositing more than 1 crore. It's not equal to or greater than 1 crore. It is more than 1 crore in any bank. Sorry, in any bank, but in a current account. Does not use the word cash deposit. Simply uses the word deposit. Okay. Could be possible. Nay, it is very clearly mentioned during the year amount or amounts in aggregate, very clearly mentioned. So it's not one time deposit, it's a requirement all throughout. Okay, now let me explain it to you briefly, something which you should be knowing. You know, certain provisions combined together. Everyone look up here. Person, as far as banking transactions are concerned, banking transaction, one is section 139(1) that will be attracted. According to section 139(1), IT return filing will be mandatory in case if cash or any deposit, cash or non-cash deposit in current account, associate deposits in current account more than 1 crore, more than 100 lakh. Okay, then according to section 194(n) that we already discussed last lecture, TDS will have to be deposited, TDS will have to be deducted, 2% TDS. This will have to be done by bank, but this is on withdrawal from any bank account. This is on 2% TDS on cash withdrawal. This is applicable. 1 minute, marker is not working. I don't know what is wrong. On cash withdrawal exceeding equal to or more than, how much is it? What is the amount? 1 crore. Exceeding 1 crore or equal to or greater than 1 crore? Exceeding 1 crore. Here also exceeding 1 crore. Here also exceeding 1 crore. This is for deposit in current account. This is for withdrawal in cash. Here cash word is not there. Here cash is there. In any bank account. Sorry. From any bank account. From any bank account. Savings or current. Savings or current. Now one more section which we had discussed in a miscellaneous provision chapter called 285BA. 285BA, annual information return, it was called as AIR. Now the name has been changed to Statement of Financial Transaction, SFT. Ye dekhega? Idhar tak. SFT, Statement of Financial Transaction. What is it? If you recollect, here anybody deposits in savings account, savings bank account, any person deposits 10 lakh or more than 10 lakh in a year. Everywhere it is a yearly limit, and nowhere it is a daily limit. It's not a daily limit anywhere. But here the sign is greater than 100 lakh, here also greater than 100 lakh. Here it is equal to or more than 10 lakhs in savings account or deposits in current account, he deposits or withdraws in cash. Here cash deposit, here also cash deposit, or here it is cash withdrawal in cash. Everywhere cash. Cash deposit of 50 lakhs or more than 50 lakh, cash withdrawal of 50 lakhs or more than 50 lakh. Everywhere it is the annual limit, nowhere it is daily limit. Amounts are different, type of account should be different. For 285BA, bank will furnish your information to government. Bank will file annual information return. If you deposit in cash, in current account 50 lakhs or more, or savings account 10 lakhs or more, but in cash. And if you withdraw in cash 50 lakhs or more from current account. This is for current account withdrawal. This is also for current account. This is for again withdrawal from any bank account. Then 2% TDS under 194N. Would you be able to remember? MCQ ke liye tricky question can be drafted. Merging more than one. There are three concepts with regards to deposits and withdrawal from bank account. Here IT return will be mandated for a person who has done this, even if his income is below basic exemption. If income was above basic exemption, then he was to file IT return otherwise also. Clear about these three things? Please be a little quick, we are running short of time. I will have to erase this. Okay, why don't you click a picture and upload it in your WhatsApp group? Huh? Please do that. Somebody please click the picture. Who's having 1+6, 1+7, 1+7? You are having 1+5, 4, 3, 2. Click the picture. OnePlus has got better clarity than iPhone also. Yes. Yes. You are asking me? What do you think? How old I am? I'm of your generation only. How much? Do you say basic exemption 5 lakhs? I'm not yet reached till the even the age of 15H form number also. I'm falling under still 15G category. Okay, clear about this. Everyone. Done, done, done. Fast. We are running short of time. You'll have to sit extra then. Break will always be there. Without break, I come here. What do you think? I'm coming here for teaching you people? Teaching is just a reason. Okay. Now proceeding further. Assessment procedure coming back. Lights off. Now, so this is the first amendment. Any person who has deposited amount exceeding 1 crore in one or more current account. One or more. Everywhere it is one or more current account with the same bank. Limit is per bank, but limit is not per current account. It is for multiple current accounts combined together with one bank. Second, he has incurred an expenditure for an amount of more than 2 lakh rupees in aggregate, more than 2 lakh rupees for foreign travel for himself or any other person. That is family member, including non-family member. Even if you have spent it for your friend in totality. Supposing you go to Bangkok, expenditure could be 30,000, 35,000, 40,000, 40,000. How much does it cost? You ask, yeah, don't worry. 2 to 3 days, mein, for 1 or 2 day picnic, you can go. So there is nothing out there. Whatever you would want to go for, that will get over in 1 or 2 days. Shopping will get over in 1 or 2 days. Okay, you won't be able to survive for more than 3 days. I mean, money will get over. But nowadays things have changed. The quality is not all that great. Bad quality. Okay, any which ways, foreign travel more than 2 lakh rupees. But more than, not equal to greater than. And third, has incurred expenditure for an amount or aggregate amount exceeding 1 lakh rupees for electricity consumption for the whole year. This will include, this is very stupid. This will include not, there is no clarification whether this is for one property or for multiple property. Answer for office, residence combined together. If I am having office also, residence also, independent electricity bill is less than 1 lakh, but annual aggregate bill for both of them combined together is more than 1 lakh. I am paying 1 lakh rupees, more than 1 lakh, I will have to file IT return. But if my income was above basic exemption, toh I was to required to file IT return otherwise also. So these 3 points which are newly inserted, which are favorite for MCQs, will play a role only for those individuals or HUFs whose income is below basic exemption otherwise, but they are depositing more than 1 crore, spending, they are going out of town, out of India. Okay, if you're going out of India, spending this much amount, then you file IT return. And he fulfills, say, the filing of IT return is different than payment of tax. One should not worry about it. Government is not creating any extra burden. Only IT return requirement has been created by government. Government does not say if you're spending this much to pay some 20,000 minimum tax. No. Tax is not paid. IT return you file. You maintain clarity. Or fulfill such other conditions as may be prescribed. Up till now, nothing prescribed. Next, or any other person other than above is required to file IT return only if the total income has exceeded the basic exemption limit. However, the basic exemption limit, the income which was to be compared with basic exemption limit was not NTI but was GTI, you know pretty well. Such person will be required to file IT return, but income which was to be compared with GTI Okay, which was to be compared with basic exemption, had to be before claiming or without giving effect to provisions of section 10A, 10B, 10BA. 10A, 10B, 10B, all three deleted. This was FTZ, free trade zone. 10B was export oriented unit, 100% EOU. 10BA was export of handicraft items. All three deleted. Or before giving effect to 1038. 1038 is also deleted. It was before giving effect to chapter 6A reductions. This is still there. These four sections are deleted. So prior to this amendment, IT return was required to be filed compulsorily only if total income by all other persons other than company, other than firm, other than ROR having assets outside India, other than person depositing more than 1 crore in current account, other than electricity bill exceeding 1 lakh, other than foreign travel expense exceeding 2 lakh, other than those people, people were required to file IT return if total income exceeded basic exemption limit before claiming so and so. But that meant that after claiming, the interpretation was that after claiming exemption under section 10, other than 1038, and after claiming brought forward losses, deduction under 10AA SEZ, and after claiming set off for brought forward loss. Before. One more item has been added here in this list, that before claiming exemption under section 54, 54B, 54D, 54EC, 54F, G, GA, GB. There are 9 sections for claiming exemption under section 54 series. Out of 9, 8 have been covered. One section is missing. Did you understand the meaning? One section missing is 54EE. 54EE. Which is similar to 54EC. 54EC mein kya tha? Sell any long-term immovable property by bonds. RECL, NHAI, IRFCL, PFCL, Power Finance Corporation, etc. within 6 months. 54EE, which was introduced few years back only, that you sell any asset, any long-term asset by units, notified units. However, those notified units, government never notified only. 54EC has become, 54EE section has kind of become redundant. My mobile it is. 54EE is not reproduced here. So any person whose income before claiming this exemption exceeds basic exemption will be required to file. Primarily 54F. Individuals HOF will be largely be covered here. The government say you claim, but you have 1 crore rupees of capital gain. You are buying another house and claiming a 100% exemption. 54, if you recollect section 54, sell residential house, buy residential house. 100% exemption will be given provided you file IT return. Provided you show it in IT return. IT return filing will be mandatory. If you don't file IT return, the exemption will not go away. Exemption will be available. Exemption will be available. But IT return filing is mandatory for such people. Nay. 54EE is still applicable for your attempt. Units were to be notified up to 31st March 2019. 17, 18, 19. 3 financial year. 31st March 19, Takmi units were to be notified. They have not notified. So technically on 54EE question will not come, but it would be wrong to say not applicable for your time. Section is applicable. If they ask you MCQ, then time limit of 6 months and everything you'll have to remember. But real life may 54EE units are not notified, or maybe they have notified, it has not become popular as usual. Clear? Okay. Then now 139A. 139A subsection 1 permanent account number, 139A permanent account number, and 139AA Aadhaar card number. Which type of people were required to apply for PAN number? Now wherever the word permanent account number is mentioned, it shall now include Aadhaar card number also. Person who is accessible to tax in respect of his own income or income of any other person. Person carrying on business profession with more than 5 lakhs of gross receipts or sales turnover. Person required to furnish IT return under 139(4A), that is trustee of the trust. Then fringe benefit tax ka return, which is scrap. And person being resident other than individual who enters into financial transaction exceeding 2,50,000 or more in a year. And 1920, person who is a director, partner, manager, secretary of the previously mentioned person who has entered into such transaction. So company has entered into such transaction exceeding 2,50,000, company has to apply for PAN number. Director, partner, trustee of such company will also have to apply for PAN number. With effect from 1st September 19, one more item added, one more clause in this list. How many people, I mean, who else will be required to apply for PAN number? The answer, every person who intends to enter into such transaction as may be prescribed by CBDT in the interest of revenue. Nothing is prescribed as such, but tomorrow if government wants to, up till now what was happening, government had to specify the for applicability of PAN number, who will have to apply, who will not have to apply. Now CBDT has been given the power or the authority, tomorrow such transactions can be notified by CBDT. What up till now what was happening, who is required to apply for PAN number, that government used to clarify by inserting a clause in 139A section. Now CBDT will do it by issuing notification. 139A subsection 5E with effect from 1st September 19. What is 139A? 139A is for PAN number. But now apart from this, talks about interchangeability of PAN number and Aadhaar number. New concept introduced by government. Wherever permanent account number is required to be quoted and associate does not have PAN number, then instead of PAN number he can give his Aadhaar number. Aadhaar number. But in such situation, PAN number will be allotted by AO. AO will allot the PAN number. Those who are not having permanent account number but are required to mention permanent account number, then wherever, then instead of PAN number he can mention his Aadhaar number if he does not have PAN number, and PAN number will be allotted to him. So lifetime he can't manage without PAN number, he can't manage with Aadhaar card number lifetime. PAN number will be allotted to him. Second point, if the person who is having PAN number and he has linked his Aadhaar number with PAN number, and he has linked Aadhaar number with PAN number, then wherever PAN number is required, instead of permanent account number, he can mention his Aadhaar number. Interchangeability of PAN number and Aadhaar number is a nonsense concept introduced by government. Real nonsense concept. There's no need only. Acha, Aadhaar number is only for individuals. I hope you are aware of that. Permanent account number is for everyone. Company, partnership firm, LLP, etc. Aadhaar number is only for individuals. So this concept is only for individuals. So making PAN number redundant for individuals. PAN number becomes redundant. Permanent account number is not required only. Only Aadhaar card number is sufficient everywhere. Any which ways. Notwithstanding anything contained in this act, two points which are useless. Every person who is required to furnish, intimate or quote his PAN number under the act. Every person who is required to quote PAN number, if he does not have PAN number, that means he has not been allotted with a permanent account number, but he possesses Aadhaar number, he may furnish, intimate or quote his Aadhaar number in lieu of PAN number. And PAN number will be allotted to him. And in such manner as may be prescribed. Second point, he has been allotted PAN number and he has linked, that is he has intimated PAN number to AO, to the income tax department or prescribed authority under 139A subsection 2. He has intimated PAN number means he has linked his Aadhaar number with PAN number. Then he may furnish, intimate or quote his Aadhaar number in lieu of PAN number. Called as interchangeability of Aadhaar number and PAN number. This is unimportant. You can cancel this. No question is expected. Somebody wants to draft a question on this. Difficult to draft a question. What question to ask on this? At the max, fill in the blanks. PAN number can be interlinked with Aadhaar number, ration card number, driving license number, passport number. Four options will be given MCQ, which I'm sure institute will not go up to that extent. They are little intelligent. 139A 6A and 139A 6B. Now new concept. There have been number of reported cases where persons were found to be giving false PAN number and false Aadhaar number. People have become so damn smart that they are able to generate a false Aadhaar number. I would say fake Aadhaar number. So photograph, I will pick up a Moise, Aadhaar number will be of Hrithik, and I will merge them, or I will put my photograph and Hrithik's Aadhaar number and I will say it is my Aadhaar number. And Aadhaar card also I will generate. People have sophisticated printers available at a damn cheap rate. Earlier such printers were costing 5-6 lakh rupees. Now such kind of printers are available for 6-7 thousand rupees also, where you can do printing on the plastic card. Arrange for a blank plastic card or PAN card, Aadhaar card, everyone can print anything. Very easy to print. And you know, editing softwares are also available free of cost. Literally, you can download from Google. And people have become smart. There have been so many reported cases where people were giving fake numbers or false number. Okay, so in order to stop these people, or in order to proceed further with the concept of Aadhaar number, government has introduced this new concept, 6A, applicable for person who is providing PAN number, Aadhaar number, and subsection 6B will be applicable for the person receiving PAN number, Aadhaar number. So the person who is furnishing PAN number, supposing I am furnishing it to Vodafone, a mobile company, for applying for mobile card, I need to have PAN number, Aadhaar card number. I hope you are aware of that. Aadhaar card number has to be linked with mobile number also. So the person who is furnishing Aadhaar number, he will have to not only quote or furnish, he will have to get it authenticated. He will have to get it authenticated. And subsection 6B for Vodafone, person who is receiving Aadhaar number, PAN number, will have to see to it that he will have to ensure that he not only collects PAN number, Aadhaar number from me, he forces me to quote, plus he will have to ensure, Vodafone will have to ensure that they get it authenticated through me. What do you mean by authentication? Authentication is a procedure whereby, online procedure, whereby the person who receives my PAN number, Aadhaar number, he will be linked with government office, a government department. If it is Aadhaar number, then UIDAI department, Unique Identification Department, or Unique Identification Authority of India. The Vodafone will have to pay some charges, will have to take permission for that thing. Whereby Vodafone will have an access to the database of Aadhaar, not the blank database, but after obtaining my number, they will have to insert my number on government website. Government will send me one OTP. OTP on my mobile, I will have to provide to Vodafone, and Vodafone will be able to verify whether Aadhaar number given by me to them is genuine or not. This is called procedure of authentication. So I will have to not only furnish, I will have to get it authenticated also. Vodafone will have to not only collect from me, but will have to get it authenticated. Both of us will be responsible. How the authentication procedure will work? It will work through OTP. I will give number. I already did this with couple of people. Standard Chartered was the bank which started this. So when Aadhaar card had to be linked with bank account, I've got bank account with 9 different banks. So I had to personally visit all the 9 banks. Very tiring concept. Okay, they could have collected it on phone also, but unfortunately, Standard Chartered was the only bank. Everywhere, Bank of India, Bank of Baroda, Dena Bank, I've got account everywhere. Everywhere I had to furnish photocopy of my PAN card, Aadhaar card. I had to go with original, show them original. They would see nonsense people, idiot. Which world are they living into? So much of technological development has taken. Standard Chartered, superb. No photocopies, nothing. I just had to tell them my Aadhaar number. They would enter my Aadhaar number in their system. They will be connected through UIDAI website. They will send me OTP. Government will send me OTP that somebody is asking for your Aadhaar number. Give him this OTP, and your Aadhaar number will be connected. I gave OTP to Standard Chartered Bank. In 1 minute, it got over. I had not to give photocopies of any document. I had not to carry any original documents. All government banks I had to carry. I felt really sad. It was very disappointing that government banks are not updated. Private banks are totally updated. Any which ways, subsection 6A is for me. Subsection 6B will be for bank, Vodafone, wherever I am submitting. Up till now, it was optional for banks also. Standard Chartered was doing it. Dena Bank was not doing. Now they will have to do it. Mandatory. Otherwise, 10,000 penalty. If I don't cooperate, 10,000 penalty on me. If bank does not cooperate, bank does not get it authenticated through me, 10,000 penalty to bank. Subsection 6A with effect from 1st September 19. Date is announced, but I don't think so. Banks are still updated. I don't think so. These banking officers, they just want every alternate Saturday off, every Sunday off, bank holidays off. They want to work till 2 o'clock only. They want to start, they want in, till though they are working till 2 o'clock, they want 1.5 hour of lunchtime. Non-working people of the country, most non-productive people, they should be all removed. Punish. Okay, 2 o'clock, till 2 o'clock bank is open, they 12 o'clock they go for lunch break. 12 o'clock. 12 baje lunch karte ho. Okay. Nonsense. After 2 o'clock, after your working hours, you have lunch, no? If your working hours are till 2 o'clock, not providing service. And Saturday kis cheez ka off? What off? Good that government started doing everything digitalization. Otherwise, we would have faced a lot of difficulties. Authentication of PAN number. Every person entering into prescribed transaction shall quote his PAN number. This is for me. Or Aadhaar number in the documents pertaining to such transactions, and also authenticate. I will have to quote PAN number or Aadhaar number plus authenticate such PAN number, Aadhaar number in the prescribed manner. However, concept is applicable only to those transactions where PAN number is compulsory. Given in Rule 114B. While opening bank account, demat account number, mobile number, etc. Buying, selling vehicles, buying, selling property, etc. Failure to quote or authenticate PAN number or Aadhaar number will attract penalty of 10,000 under 270B section for each such failure or default. This is on me. Explanation to 139A. What do you mean by authentication? Authentication means a process by which PAN number, Aadhaar number provided by me along with my demographic or biometric information. Reliance Jio, they were the first people to start off with this. Reliance Jio people sit with a small machine. You go to any Reliance Jio office, you don't have to give your identification, nothing. You put your this without licking. You just put it on the machine and everything through your biometric information, through your thumb impression or eye retina impression, all your details will be available in front of the officer at Reliance Jio. Other people are not that well equipped, but Reliance Jio has started. Okay, the process by which PAN number or Aadhaar number of an individual is submitted by bank, I will submit to bank, bank will submit to income tax authority or the prescribed authority or prescribed agency for its verification, and such authority or agency, that is government department, will verify online the correctness or otherwise of the same on the basis of information available with government record. And will reply immediately through OTP. I don't have to give my date of birth. My date of birth will be whatever date of birth is registered for Aadhaar number, PAN number, that will be appearing in front of the officer. 139A6B. This is for Vodafone. This is for bank. Every person receiving any document relating to transactions which are referred to in 139A6A. That means transaction or opening bank account, demat account, telephone connection, mobile connection, buying, selling of vehicles, etc. shall ensure that Vodafone will have to ensure that PAN number, Aadhaar number has been duly quoted, and not only quoted, it is duly authenticated also. Failure by such person, bank will be attracting 10,000 penalty for each such default. Clear? 139AA. Next. 139AA is Aadhaar number. Aadhaar number is required to be quoted in every PAN application and IT return also. Now, government had been announcing various dates for those people who already have Aadhaar number. They are required to link their Aadhaar number with PAN number. Non-linking would result into invalidation of PAN number. PAN number was to become, permanent account number was to become invalid. So people ask government, sir, PAN number becomes invalid, so what if I apply again for PAN number? Again you make it invalid, again I will apply. Again you make it invalid, again I will apply. I will keep on applying. Chalega kya? To government clarified, okay, sorry, mistake. PAN number will not become invalid as recommended by Arun Jaitley. PAN number will become inoperative. 1st September onwards, PAN number will become inoperative. You cannot use that PAN number. When you try to authenticate, it will not be authenticated unless linked with Aadhaar number. One cannot apply fresh PAN number also. Same PAN number, one will have to link it with Aadhaar card number after the notified date. The date notified has been changed again and again. Latest date is 31st March 2020. 31st March 2020. Earlier it was 31st December 2019. Before that it was 30th September 19. Before that dates have been extended 5-6 times because government has not been able to get it implemented 100%. But it's a nice process. But because of this, either PAN number becomes redundant or Aadhaar number becomes redundant. Aadhaar number only for individual HUF, individuals. Other than individuals, so Aadhaar card number is not possible only. Non-residents are exempted, but they are exempted only. So this whatever we are discussing is applicable only for those who are required to. Correct. So exceptions are given separately. In 139AA, three exceptions. Person who is not a citizen of India, person who is non-resident in India, person who is above the age of 80 years, and person residing in a state of Jammu Kashmir, Assam, Meghalaya, JAM, JAM. Jammu Kashmir, Assam, Meghalaya. Four people are exempted from the requirements of linking Aadhaar number. Government has not incorporated any changes out it here, unfortunately. Even at some places, still Jammu and Kashmir is mentioned as a state in some of the acts. Halaki Jammu Kashmir is now union territory. Okay, any which ways. Okay, now we'll make the PAN number inoperative after the notified date. Self-assessment tax, section 140. Every person who's required to file IT return, before filing IT return, he has to ensure that whatever taxes are payable by him, if any tax is still payable, he has to pay before filing the IT return. But the tax payable, still payable, was to be computed after claiming advance tax ka credit, TDS, TCS credit, after claiming MAT credit, AMT credit, DTAA relief, any other rebate relief. One more item is added, that after claiming relief under section 89 with regards to arrears of salary. Okay, but retrospectively added from AY78. This is unimportant amendment. I'm not considering this as an amendment at all. 89.1. We had discussed in TDS chapter also. Okay, TDS chapter under 192 section. Earlier year salary is now received. Arrears of salary. Not the outstanding salary. Arrears of salary which is taxable in the current year. Had this salary been received in the respective year, you would have fallen under 20% slab. But because it is received in the current year, you are falling under 30% slab. Slab changes. Or you would have fallen under 5% slab, but now you are falling under 20% slab. Correct. So not only because different slab rates were there at that time and today the slab rates have changed, not because of that, even if otherwise also, even if the rates were same, but this arrear would have been received that time. So your salary had been 8 lakh rupees every year, 8 lakh rupees. Now you are receiving 3 lakhs arrears. So 3 lakh received in the current year makes you fall under partially under 30% slab. Had it been received that time only, you would have been taxed at 20% rate. So extra tax that you are paying will be allowed as a relief. So now self-assessment tax will be after claiming relief under section 89. Nonsense amendment it is. E-assessment. Now e-assessment concept is introduced by virtue of section 143.3a. Electronic assessment, or it is called as faceless assessment. This I will discuss towards the end if you want, or maybe we can discuss right now, whatever you want, because this is absolutely unimportant. This I have covered during the last four pages. End. Okay, it is unimportant. If somebody wants to sit, you can sit. If you do not wish to sit, you can bunk. Or I will explain it to you briefly in 5 minutes, what is it? And then detailed explanation will take around half an hour. That's why. Half an hour. That's why. Okay, so we'll do it later towards the end of the chapter. And in my notes also I have covered towards the end in the last four pages. Page number 27, 28, 29, 30. Okay. Why it is unimportant? Because here e-assessment will be done through a particular process including mobile app, which is yet to be developed by Income Tax Department. Income Tax officers also objected. Sir, we are not ready. Why are you announcing it right now? We are not ready yet. Training is to be given. Infrastructure is to be set up for video conferencing, internet facility. Mumbai may we have internet, high speed, super high speed internet. Small villages may it's not there. Recently, December month may, I had been to one of the village of Gujarat. The internet was very weak, or internet was not there only almost. Many places I could not catch the internet connection. So it's not ready. Now e-assessment is introduced. Nirmala Sitharaman, so much in a hurry. There was no need. Let people settle down first. Okay, any which ways. You want to have a break right now? Huh? You people have just come, so you cannot vote for a break. Okay, fine, no problem. So we'll continue with this. Appeals and revision chapter, only one small amendment has been made. If you recollect, appeal can be, there are four levels of appeal at hierarchy. CIT appeal, ITED, High Court, Supreme Court. Assessee can file appeal at all the levels, but department cannot start with CIT appeal. Department has to start with ITED. I hope you know the reasons why. Well, if you also recollect, there were some limits for monetary limits for department to file appeal to ITAT High Court Supreme Court. If the tax amount or the tax effect involved in the matter exceeded the monetary limit specified by CBDT, then only department could file appeal. Otherwise, department not allowed to file appeal. The monetary limits were changed couple of times recently, multiple times changed. Earlier limits were different in 2015, then 2017, then 2018 it was changed, but these limits are for department, questions not expected. For filing appeal by department to ITAT, the tax effect had to exceed 10 lakh rupees, then it was increased to 20. For filing appeal to High Court, the amount of tax effect had to exceed 20 lakh rupees, then it was increased to 25, now increased to 50. And for filing appeal to Supreme Court, the amount of tax effect had to exceed 100 lakhs. These were the limits as per 2018 wala circular. These limits are again changed for 8th August 19. CBDT issued another circular, 8th August 19. Aray, abhi 1 year back they issued circular. Again they changed. Prior to that they had issued 1 year back. So many times limits revised. Limits were few years back in 2015. 2015 mein limits were 2 lakhs, 5 lakh, 10 lakh. 2 lakh, 5 lakh, 10 lakh. Dhadadhadadhad limits are revised and now the new limits, these existing limits cancel. New limits shot up to CBDT circular 8th August 19. For ITAT 50 lakh, High Court 100 lakh, Supreme Court 200 lakh. How much was it earlier? 20, 50, 100. Now 100 is shifted, 50 is shifted here, 100 is shifted here. One step promotion. A new limit 200. Clear? That's it. There is no other amendment. This is less important. Questions not expected on this.